Good evening, my name is Patricia Duff. Welcome to the Common Good. I'm going to be brief, but if you haven't been here before, you should know that the Common Good tries to, in its forums, its initiatives, and its programs, to support the best of democratic values. And of course, by that we mean open debate and free press. We've got to have opportunity for all. We have to have, we have to have good governance for the people, of course, as relates to that, and protection of our natural resources. That includes our people and our lands and our waters. So we're all about that. And tonight, this film relates to at least a couple of those values. Certainly, freedom of the press, and the importance of a free press to democracy and to governance. So we're thrilled to have Bob Friedman, the producer, and his team here tonight to present this film, which is all about how journalists around the world ferreted out some of the most interesting and shocking information that goes to corruption in and around the world. So we're very excited to have this film. Bob, I'm so excited to have you. We've talked about this for the last couple of months. And Bob is a veteran, 30-year veteran in the entertainment business at Radical Media and Entertainment, at AOL, at New Line Cinema, at New Line Theater, all as a senior executive president, CEO. And so, welcome, Bob. Thank you so much for being here. I'm going to let you take over. A little later, you will be meeting the director, Alex Winter, and Stephanie Ruhle, our moderator, and of course, one of the valiant members of the press who investigated this story throughout the last couple of years, Kevin Hall, and received the Pulitzer Prize. So please, please give a warm welcome to Bob Friedman.
You know, I'm telling people it's my knee, because when you say it's a hip, you kind of feel old, but I just had my hip replaced last week, so you have to excuse me for sort of using this cane. Thank you for Patricia. For inviting us to screen the film with you. We think our values, and we think this film aligns very closely with what you're doing with the Common Good, so we're thrilled to death. Following the film, as Patricia mentioned, we're going to have a panel. The panel will include our director, Alex Winter. He's an award-winning filmmaker whose credits include Deep Web, Trust the Machine, and some of you will sit there and take a look and realize that it is Bill from Bill and Ted's Adventure. He is the real Bill. He had worked actually at Viacom and MTV many years when I was there as well. And he's just a fabulous award-winning director. We also have here Kevin Hall, who came in from Washington, who's from McClatchy, we'll hear a little bit more later, who won the Pulitzer Prize for his work on the Panama Papers. He's an amazing character himself, and I think you'll also hear a few things that you will not see in the film that have occurred since. That is just sort of great, fun stuff. There is, and Kevin, I just want you to know, there is some press here, so you should just be aware that anything you say could show up somewhere else. And obviously, Stephanie Ruhle, who is the host of MSNBC Live, and has a show, Belcher and Rule herself, on the weekends on MSNBC. I've spent many years in this business, but clearly we think that there's no better time for a discussion of and a look into what's sort of going on in the global investment business. Having said that, the rise of a globalized class of world leaders, which Variety in its review said are displaying behaviors that were once associated with banana republics, but what today seem to be turning into a new normal as we're living through this. So I hope you enjoy the film. It's only 90 minutes, and we'll have the panel after. It's a pretty quick 90 minutes. So thank you all for coming, and we'll join you on the panel later.
Are you going to stay?
Why don't you guys all come in? Thank you so much all for coming out on this treacherous night to see a movie that is quite a treacherous story. My name is Stephanie Ruhle. I'm an anchor with MSNBC. I am honored. Thank you. Oh, God. Thanks. I'm honored to be here. I'm floored. I'm floored by the story. I think, like many of you, I think lots of us, I at least, had read a lot. All right. We'll go double. All right, then. For many of us, at least for me, I can say I definitely reported on the story. We read a lot about it. We saw a decent amount. But until you see it in its entirety, even those final credits, kind of getting your head around the amount of people that are currently sitting in jail, it's sort of a wow. So for us to have the opportunity to sit down with the reporter, the filmmaker, and the producer, and how all this came together, I'm excited to have this conversation. So why don't you guys all join me?
Go ahead.
Great.
Just for pity.
Perfect.
Great, thank you.
Bob Friedman, Alex Winter, Kevin Hall, thank you all for sharing this with us.
Thanks for coming. Thank you.
I'd like to sort of go in succession. I'd love to start with sort of the reporting, the movie making, and sort of how you brought this all to us. Kevin, to you first. Take me to the McClatchy team. How did you all get your head and hands around covering this behemoth?
Well, the short version is we knew we wanted to be part of it. The Miami Herald is our flagship paper. It was Mike Ritter's flagship paper, and has since kind of become so in McClatchy. And Latin America is the focus. These documents are in Spanish and Portuguese.
Can you hear him in the back?
Okay, back there?
I don't think so.
One, two, huh? Is that any better?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll just literally have my mouth on this. No pictures, please. The Miami Herald, being Latin America focused, was a natural partner. And Tim Johnson, who you saw in the movie, the bearded fellow, Marissa, all three of us had worked in Latin America, so it was a natural fit. We all three spoke Spanish. I spoke Portuguese, so all of that together made us a natural fit for the project. And then the rest of it was just old-fashioned grind work. This was not sexy. This was going down rabbit hole after rabbit hole.
Did you raise your hand for it?
Yes. I was the guy in the lead-in of it. I had headed something called the Society of American Business Editors and Writers, and as part of that, I had had Mike Hudson, who was one of the lead guys at ICNJ at the time, speak in Toronto. We formed a relationship. He also knew Latin America well. So we had been talking about doing something in Argentina when this dropped in their lap, and so we already had an ongoing relationship, and from there we were able to develop it further.
Help us understand how you stuck to this story, because right now in the world of journalism, whether we like it or not, we're living in a short-term, immediate gratification, let me get clicks and noise and headlines as fast as possible. And the first way you described reporting this was rabbit hole after rabbit hole.
Yeah. This I don't think this could happen today. I think we were at the tail end of being able to do something like this.
Stay on that. Explain that.
Well, I simply don't think newspapers were in free fall as an industry. I'm not referring to my chain in particular. I mean, you've seen the headlines with hedge funds trying to buy newspaper chains to sell their assets. And, you know, I BuzzFeed layoffs, HuffPost layoffs. Across the board, I think we're in an industry that's facing a lot of challenges. The good news is more people are reading news than ever before. The bad news is the only people who seem to be able to monetize that are Google and Facebook. So, you know, that's kind of where we are. So I don't think, I literally worked 15 months on nothing but this. My wife didn't know what I was doing. Nobody at the chain knew what I was doing. That's the amount of secrecy, because you couldn't get any of this out.
One more time. For 15 months, and I know, I promise, you two are looking at me going, I didn't come here for my health. But for 15 months, At what point did you know, you always knew I was on to something, but at what point did you know, there's a real string I'm pulling on, I can tell a story here?
We knew right away. We knew right away. The problem was, as Alex captured in the movie, seeing the document is only the first part of it. Most, with the exception of the Russians, nobody had that level of detail. You had to go cross-reference that against properties and addresses and try to find corporate industries in different parts of the world. You know, so that was, once you found someone you thought was the person, I'll give you an example. We spent almost 6 months on a guy who we were convinced was a CIA. He had been a top CIA guy, then he was a Lockheed. He turned out he had the same name and almost the same history as another guy who would come through the military and come through the arm of the Air Force. And two guys, same name, same middle name, almost same background. And it wasn't, and the CIA wouldn't talk to us about it, the military wouldn't give us personnel records. You know, 6 months of work before we finally determined this is, there were two guys with the same name, whose name I won't name. But I guess I named it because we didn't publish his name, Michael A. Delvecchio, who
what'd the A stand for? What'd the A stand for?
Alfred, I think.
But one
had been the CIA and it was Lockheed Martin, and the other had come up through the Air Force and had been in satellite systems. And then went into the offshore business and had offices in Mexico, LA, Spain, and Malta. So this, you know, that's the kind of thing, you know, one part of it. And Marissa, who you saw in the movie, who's the bulldog, wrote the guy down and got him to talk, and then his lawyer called back and complimented her for getting him to talk.
Alex, what intrigued you to tell the story? It's a complicated one.
Documentaries are really good for sort of emotionalizing and encapsulating narratives. And I've done several other films in sort of the journalism and the encryption and the sort of cyber areas. So they're all areas I know well. And this story slams all of those things together. So it's a really important 21st century news story for a number of obvious reasons. But it was also a story that I felt had not been properly absorbed. Mm-hmm. For the two reasons, that one being that it is incredibly complicated, and the other is that it was suppressed. You know, and so you have a story where the bad guys are on every, you know, both sides of the political aisle, in every corner of government and business and crime. So nobody really wanted the story to have legs, despite the amount of coverage that it initially broke. It seemed like a really, when Bobby and Bungalow came to me, you know, they had been talking to Kevin. I was very aware of the story. I have friends, journalists, and other at The Guardian and other places around the world that had worked on the story. And it struck me as a really good idea for a doc, because I just felt like it was to me, the significance of the story is an emotional response that you have to the essence of what is actually happening here. If you can convey that, and I figured that people would have the same response to it that I did.
When you look at the final product, is that the movie you thought you were going to make?
No, you never make the movie you think you're going to make. You make like 9 different versions of the movie, and none of those end up being the movie you make. It's all very different. I mean, there are so many things that change while you're making a film. And Kevin and I started working together right away. And then I got in with Bastian and Frederick in Munich, and I was in London, I was in Panama. And the more I learned about the actual journalists, the more I started to understand the real underpinning of this, the sort of systemic corruption that was at play. But then I also formed relationships, like with Daphne's son, Matthew, who I'm very close friends with now. So what I didn't expect, I thought my film was going to be a little bit more retrospective, even though very tight retrospective, because all this stuff had just happened. But you know, Daphne was killed while I was in the cold room in London at The Guardian. I mean, things were happening while we were shooting. So that changed the tenor of
what
the film was.
How much did that change the narrative?
A lot. I mean, I would argue, and I want to let Kevin speak to this because he was inside it. But it changes the narrative in two ways. One is well, obviously in terms of the film, in terms of the Panama Papers themselves and how people were responding to that story, and the significance of having. The really scary thing about the times that we're in is that when Daphne was assassinated, a journalist being killed in an EU country is really, really, really uncommon, and sent shockwaves through the journalistic community. And when I was, I've done a lot of stuff with journalists who are imprisoned, journalists under siege in one way or another. Almost all the journalists I was dealing with around the world were not worried that they were going to be killed. They might have been worried about having their encryption, their sources blown, their encryption screwed up, various foreign actors coming at them or intelligence people coming at them for one reason or another. The world changed after Daphne's death for the journalists, and the rest of the world didn't catch up to that until, by Khashoggi's death, the rest of the world was like, oh, this is happening now. The general landscape of the world has shifted. The only reason I said there were two aspects was the other aspect was, and I'm curious to know your opinion on this, was all the journalists I knew were changed. Like they weren't taking it at face value that they weren't at risk anymore. Like my friends in Germany, people in The Guardian, people in different countries, they all felt now that they were potentially at risk of being killed when before they really didn't live in that world.
Okay, Jeremy, for compliment Alex, he was able to synthesize a lot of different threads that we were all working individually, publishing our own stories. So one of the things that Alex did so brilliantly was make that connection with income inequality. I think we all kind of hinted at it, but we never had it as a theme. And then when you step back and look at it as Alex did with a step back, you understand really that connection. He helped us kind of see what sometimes we didn't see. So. That compliment. Going to the question about safety. Daphne changed everything, but it's not just Daphne, it's the times and what has become acceptable. BBC cameraman was attacked last night in El Paso during the rally, didn't seem to get much negative attention from the Trump campaign, the Trump administration. We have key cards, we've had threats, we've had things, people saying they're going to wait. Gun outside our offices, so we have guards, we have, shatterproof window. That's all that is time. It's not because of Daphne, but it's the times we are now in, the pizza thing in Washington kind of underscored that.
The shooting in Annapolis.
Yeah.
Yeah. I live right 10 minutes away from here, so it hit home for our highest, of course, is part of the McClatchy family, so his brother was killed. So yeah, so it's unfortunate. Reality separate from Daphne, but Daphne certainly brought that point home. I think the impunity is what is so shocking about Daphne. The latest news, probably never talked about this earlier, and I hope I'm not stealing his thunder, but I'm just saying that one of the things that's happened is Matthew, just this week, has asked the German, has made it known that he took Daphne's computers, three hard drives, gave to the German authorities because he didn't trust the police in Malta to investigate. Malta has not asked for any of that information. So the Malta authorities wiped their hands. Muscat is still there. And if you saw the backdrop of that, if you saw on the screen, Alex Captain Phil Baku Bashis, what that was looking at is whether or not the Muscat family was helping the Azeri ruling family move money and hide money. And that's something that is continuing.
My gosh. Bobby, get yourself into this story. How did you pursue this project?
Well,
why?
To be honest, we love docs. We've done Paradise Lost. We've done a bunch of other things. And we had a relationship with McClatchy. And I heard this story. And the first time we heard this story, what was really interesting to us
was that there were 375 journalists who could keep a secret for a number of years. And literally, we thought that was going to be the story. And I actually, it was Kevin. It's great in these big companies when you can reach out to someone who was just so amazing as Kevin, who was working on this. And this was his beat. And then subsequently, his beat included Trump. So by definition, it was like an interesting beat to have. And as this evolved, the story also evolved. So when we found, you know, Alex, who is an amazing storyteller and documentarian, and also my hero in Bill and Ted's Adventures, as I mentioned before, I have to be honest. Having done Dumb and Dumber, I can tell you sort of that's where my excitement goes.
But we're about to do Mock. Yeah.
But when you think about, like, up to 2013, there was like something like $300 billion, which has been screwed up and hidden, and that's 10% of the health benefits of Americans today, or 4 years of education that could be done in America. So that the layers of this story kept going. There were a few of the layers which, to be honest, at some points, and I would throw this to Kevin, because I really want you to listen to these guys, because we sit with our mouths open still listening to these guys who have lived this day in and day out. But, you know, there was a minute there where we thought, with the Trump situation, you know, here was someone who said, I don't believe in offshore financing, and not all offshore financing is illegal. Maybe 50% of it is, and you can, you know, send trillions of dollars to Iran and be a bank and do that secretly. So we thought maybe, like everyone thinks, that there may be something big enough to sort of nail people in American politics, but, you know, who knows if there ever will be. But certainly it was an element of the story, but the story kept changing. And it was interesting because Alex, I would get these calls and talking about being afraid. You know, all of our correspondence was encrypted. So anything that we did online, our phone calls, I would say to my wife, and she just thought that I was an erotic Jew, saying that I'm,
you might be.
I'm afraid, but I am probably as well. But I was like a little nervous that, you know, someone would talk to me. And but it was really frightening as this thing was evolving. But, you know, as the story evolved, I mean, you guys were sort of following it day by day, so I would throw it back to you guys. And there's some new stuff, by the way, that, you know, that I was hearing from Kevin. That is like amazing stuff that wasn't in the movie.
Anything you can share with us?
Yeah, there had been some development. One of the things I particularly like is Alex pulled the scene of Letitia Montoya saying that wasn't her, you saw the passport, but you saw that was her. No, I don't know what she did. I think she's gone to the country. We also reached her on the telephone where she said the same thing. No, I think she's in the interior. She's in the interior of the country. No, it's clearly her. You can see she's not a woman with means. And there was another woman, I think her name was North Korean shell companies, who the same thing was
Philippines.
Married to a Frenchman who then put her on all these companies. They're cogs in the system. The new latest news, I guess, is we have finally a U.S. indictment, Ramsey Owens.
Who you and I spoke to.
Yes, we spoke to on his birthday.
Yeah.
He came to the phone to get a job. We're calling to give him a birthday.
Not so much.
And does anybody remember Congressman Bob Bowman from Maryland, who resigned in scandal in the 70s? Well, he runs something called the Sovereign Society, which is, you know, it's kind of a, you know, get into gold, the world's coming to an end type thing. Newsletter. But he also promoted the most economic at these different offshore conferences, five-year well protection. And he then, of course, did a whole story on him later on. He did, oh my God, I already knew these people. Yeah, I think maybe we talked a couple times. Of course, we had the emails. And there was kind of this Kugler Ross stages of acceptance where, no, I have nothing. Oh, I know. But it didn't hold anything. Well, yeah, but you kind of got there eventually. And in his case, he referred to Ramsey Owens as Argo Irishman. And so Argo Irishman is now facing U.S. charges. He can't leave Panama. He's under house arrest with an ankle bracelet. And the first U.S. citizen who was charged is a Boston-based accountant, Peter Gaffney, he appeared in court December 17th, so at least there's a prosecution. But it is pretty striking that virtually nothing has been done. Nevada, I don't mean to change their laws to at least have a real contact. It's, you know, marginal. And you don't have to offshore. There are no secrets. You go to Florida and do a big project right now. It's looking at all this Latin wealth in Miami. It's hidden behind Florida LLCs, traced back to Delaware LLCs. You don't even have to go offshore for this.
All right, we're going to open up to questions.
Have you run the Foreign Agent Registration Act through the database again lately?
Haven't done it lately, but I do it on a regular basis, not the entire. I have downloaded the whole thing and done a batch search. Probably would have been a smart thing to do at the time. We have total register of this. But we do find there's a couple of people online and search people who hate me and smearing online. Some of them are in this offshore space who are also late to register as para agents. But there's definitely overlap, and there's overlap in another way, although almost a lot of the big name Washington firms have dealt with any number of oligarchs and companies who are also Lovatic and Access Industries, who's one of the more recent ones that, you know, people are registering as para agents representing Russian entities.
Thank you very much for what we've enjoyed this evening. I wonder if there's been any intersection with your investigations and the Mueller investigation.
Let's see where the question's coming from.
She's asking if there's any intersection between your reporting and the Mueller investigation.
Well, given that he hasn't. Hey, Bob, give me a call. We have a sense that some of the Ukrainians on the inauguration maybe as a result of some of the reporting, and some of that overlaps with Panama Papers.
Manafort, right?
And Manafort, of course, would be the biggest part of Deripaska. His lawsuit with Manafort and the alleged stolen money that Manafort ever paid him for played out in Panama Papers as well, which was part of that. Gates, less so. Probably a Brody, more in the Paradise Papers space.
Given that all roads led to Mossack Fonseca, this one single law firm in Panama, I'm wondering, are there other law firms that might have similar knife-producing activities?
There's a couple things. One is, Mossack was global, so the offices were all over the world, including here in the U.S. The same team behind the Panama Papers broke the Paradise Papers not long after the Panama Papers broke, which was Appleby, another firm that dealt largely in multinationals. Went a long way towards exposing what we kind of already knew, which is that multinational corporations are as guilty of this as drug cartels in, you know, Mexico. So, and there are many. You know, when I was in Panama shooting, they were talking to me about other Panamanian law firms that were getting away with the same thing that Mossack was doing.
Well, when Alex and I were on the phone with the lawyer, he took us to another competitor by a shout name.
Yeah.
Why are you talking to us? They're bigger and they're
just not as successful.
Yeah.
It isn't as successful as that. But, you know, the Applebee's, the Paradise, I recently finally got access to the Paradise Papers, so and I'm one of the journalists who has access to most sets of data, which is interesting to now be able to have a basic comparison. Applebee's is the clean shirt. It's where the ultra-wealthy, it's where the Wilbur Rosses go versus, you know, the kind of common penny stock scammers who need that anonymity. So Applebee's uses nicer language than Mossack Fonseca. But Bitcoin is one of the areas that was really interesting. Because I know Alex is considered world interested. So I've had kind of an ongoing file. Someday maybe I'll do something, maybe I won't. But there's a particular Bitcoin case in there where they're saying, their compliance office is saying, don't touch this, this is too risky. And marketing people win the day by arguing it's not a regulated business, so people lose a bit of money, it's not our problem. We're just providing a service and they go ahead and do it.
Right.
So it goes back to what we were saying in the movie, they don't mind dirty money, they just have to have a clean way to do it. That was another example where Applebee's does it too.
All right, this is the last question. So whomever has questions, I want you to just close your eyes for a second and ask yourself, is this the most important question in the room? And if you can answer yes,
multi-part question.
If you can answer yes, I have the most valuable question in the room, then... Okay, well then there you go.
So my question is, and Stephanie, I'd love you to get your opinion on this. What, in America, what can be done with regulations and rules that might change the idea of blind LLCs and offshore untaxable wealth moving and across the world? What can be done?
I think the saddest thing is political will. And the problem is, with this, everyone in power is in cahoots, whether it's business or politics. So, you know, why was it so exciting at the end of the year that you saw anything happen on criminal justice reform? Because criminal justice reform is trying to help people who don't even have the right to vote, right? So when you think about what makes something happen, it has to be will. And the money and power here are incentivized to keep the system in place. It's why income inequality has become as exaggerated as it has, in my opinion.
I meant to ask that question, Bob. It's because yours is an industry, not your more Hollywood. It's a lot of foreign money coming into Hollywood, a lot of Russian money in Hollywood now. Wondered if that's added, and we certainly know that Lenin Levandic bought out at least one of
Steve Mnuchin's
partners. Teased a little bit in the movie, but didn't completely go there. How much do you think Hollywood is rethinking the offshore space? Do you have any sense?
To be honest, I don't think it's unique to Hollywood. I think it's in a lot of businesses, and probably the Hollywood reaction has been that the money wasn't necessarily good. You saw what happened with the Asian market, and the money was there, and then all of a sudden it evaporated. You know, the only thing that I would add to that question is, which was of interest to us, and certainly I think clearly defined in the movie by both of you guys, is the how. I mean, it is amazing to think how some of this could have happened, but we are living at a time in a political world that we're saying to ourselves every night, how is this happening with the administration going on? And the only thing that I would say on a positive note is that it's so great that our kids are getting very educated on how this crap works, which is a great thing. And I thank people like you. And in Hollywood, when you're selling a movie, and I know there's some people here from Epix and some of the people who funded this, and all of a sudden in the middle of this, the guy that you've worked with wins a Pulitzer Prize that is just amazing and was so accessible with someone who went on planes secretly around the world. It is just, this has been an amazing experience, and I'm just so thrilled that people here were interested in it.
What a way to end it!
Wow. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie, for doing this tonight. I know it's always a kind of big schedule, but all of you, you were wonderful. The movie is really fantastic. Thank you one more time.
Thank all of you. My answer to your question, though, is it all comes down to the U.S., and if we fix it here, it'll
fix it
be fixed everywhere. Right.